And welcome to the 23rd meeting in 2024 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The only public item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the financial memorandum for the Disability Commissioner Scotland Bill. For this session, we are joined by Jeremy Balfour, the member in charge of the bill. He is accompanied by Nick Hawthorne, Senior Clerk, and Liz Anderson, Assistant Clerk, both from the Non-Government Bills Unit. I welcome Jeremy to the meeting and invite him to make a short opening statement. Jeremy.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, colleagues. I introduced the Disability Commissioner Scotland Bill in February this year, having obtained the right to introduce a member's bill. The bill will establish a Disability Commissioner for Scotland, whose primary function will be to promote and safeguard the rights of disabled people. To achieve this, the Commission will promote the awareness and understanding of the rights of disabled people, keep law, policy and practice in relation to the rights of disabled people under review, promote best practice by service providers, and promote Commission undertake and publish research relating to the rights of disabled people. The Commissioner may also carry out investigation into what means and to what extent a service provider has regard to the rights, interests and views of disabled people or a disabled person in making decisions and taking actions that affect them. The financial memorandum which accompanies the bill was drafted by the Non-Government Bills Unit on my behalf. In developing the financial memorandum, NGBU consulted with the Scottish Parliament corporate body officials, and a draft financial memorandum and the draft bill was shared with SPCB officials prior to the bill's introduction. In addition, NGBU drew information from recent financial memorandums for bills which established commissioners, as well as the annual accounts of existing commissioners. The policy behind the bill and the details of a financial memorandum were also developed using the criteria of Session 2 Finance Committee as valuable context. The financial memorandum sets out my strong preference that the Commissioner should share accommodation and services with other public bodies wherever possible in order to reduce costs. However, provision for the location of the Commissioner's accommodation and the sharing of premises, staff services or other resources will be subject to any direction from SPCB and the availability of such premises and services at the point that the Commissioner being established. The financial memorandum estimates that initially the Commissioner will have 4 staff members. The estimated remuneration of the Commissioner and the staff is based upon the information provided by SPCB officials. I consider it appropriate to provide estimated costs for 4 staff members, as this is in line with the staffing numbers of recently or soon to be established commissioners. Should the commissioner seek to employ additional staff, approval will be sought from SPCB. As the committee will be aware, the FM are the best estimates based on the information that are available at the time. I note the 3 responses to the committee's call for views on the financial memorandum and take on board the points made in them. I further note the Scottish Government's correspondence with the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee, in which the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice notes that the cost estimates seem to broadly reflect what would be expected with the introduction of a new Commissioner's role. I consider the cost incurred in estimating a Disability Commissioner to be an investment in disabled people that is long overdue. Establishing a Commission will ensure that disabled people have a champion who will promote and safeguard their rights. In being focused solely on the needs of disabled people, rather than having a remit spread over different protected characteristics, the Commissioner will give disabled people the prioritisation that they need and deserve. I am happy, as always, to take questions from the committee. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much for that opening statement, Jeremy. I think, obviously, the first thing that we would want to ask is why you feel a Commissioner is the best route forward in terms of promoting the rights and safeguarding those of disabled people, and what gaps there are in current government provision that makes you feel that this is the best way forward?
I think pre-COVID, there was an argument for a Disability Commissioner quite strongly. I think during the COVID period and since COVID, the evidence points that disabled individuals have been left behind more than any other sector within society. If you look at regard to the services that are now being provided for disabled people, the lack of engagement that often happens at a local level that disabled people face, then the need for that voice to be heard within civic society, I think, has grown more and more. I think it's often said to me by disabled people, particularly parents of disabled children, it takes all my energy to get me out of bed in the morning. And the thought of then having to campaign and to lobby and to promote disabled issues often goes beyond what, if you like, the average, if it's such a thing, disabled person can deal with. So we've had different commissioners, different commissions around for 10, 15, 20 years. But if you look at the work that they have done, it has been very rarely focused on disabled issues and disabled rights. And I think the disability community, and this has come out quite strongly in the evidence sessions before the Equalities Committee, feel that they are just not being heard and that they feel that they are being left behind. So I think the time now for the Commissioner to have that voice, not only to government and to Parliament, but to local authorities, to NHS boards, is the time now that we need to do it.
Is it not, though, the role of councillors and MSPs and MPs, indeed, to advocate for constituents who are disabled and work with community organisations and, indeed, others to advocate for their rights? I mean, one of the issues that we've had in terms of the kind of inquiry we've done into the commissioner landscape is the issue of complexity and duplication. And there's concerns that this would actually add to that without actually delivering what you would want to do, because it would just be effectively another advocacy body, as opposed to, rather than going directly to, for example, ministers or parliamentarians, etc. What do you say to that?
I mean, absolutely, we as MSPs, MPs, local councillors should be advocating on behalf of our constituents, but that doesn't deal with the broader issues, the policy issues that are coming out of government, coming out of a parliament, where you do need a coordinated voice. You need somebody that can bring together the disability community so that they can speak into Parliament. I mean, I think it is noticeable, certainly in my 8 years that I've been here, how it, very infrequently you hear the disabled community speaking as one voice. And a part of that is because it is very difficult for disabled people to find that energy and even the availability and the accessibility of places. Clearly, I'm not here to write the job description if we end up with a disability commissioner. But I do think there will be a role for them to be able to not just be an advocacy. It has to be beyond that. It has to be somebody who is looking at where policy is and where policy should be going and engaging with government, parliament and other public bodies to produce that. In a similar role to that of a children's commissioner. And I think, you know, I absolutely welcome, I think, your review that you're doing of commissioners. And I think it's something we as a parliament have to address. But it needs to be done holistically. It needs to be done in a way that goes back and looks at what have previous commissioners done and are doing. And I am just slightly concerned that, just due to timing, that we're now saying, well, let's pull up the drawbridge now and stop at this point. And I think if we're going to have a holistic review, then let's do that. But again, as a parliament, we have passed a commissioner within the last year in regard to patients' rights. We've got legislation which will come through probably before the end of this year, which will give victims and witnesses a commissioner's right. So as a parliament, we are not necessarily saying commissioners are wrong. And my concern is that we need to do it holistically and come up with that all-round approach. And obviously the government itself is, I think, got at least one, if not two, other commissioners planned before the end of this parliament.
Yeah, it makes me see where the government will proceed with those. I mean, you talk about, you know, the community of disabled people, but there's a vast array of disabilities, you know, and a colossal number of people who have a disability, one or more in Scotland. How would a commissioner prioritise, you know, in terms of that huge range of different disabilities, for example? Because we've got many groups who advocate for specific types of disability, as we all know, and they focus on that particular group, whereas a commissioner would suddenly have this incredibly wide range of organisations and people and issues to deal with.
Yeah, I mean, I think that was one of the questions I actually had in my own mind as I was going forward in regard to that. I think the consultation, which I did pre-bill, gave me some indication, and then last year I spent the summer doing a bit of a tour around Scotland, talking to different disability groups and individuals. And actually what has become really clear is that, absolutely right, you know, it's very different if you're in a wheelchair compared to if you have a hidden disability, if you've got a visual impairment compared to even a hearing loss. The issues are very different. But actually, the topics that you're being discriminated on are almost the same. So it's around education, it's around health, it's around transport. So whether you are a wheelchair user or whether you have a hidden disability, the actual issues that you are facing are almost identical. And that's come really clear in regard to the evidence that's come out from the consultation and from my own experience. And so I don't see there being some kind of listing to say, you know, I spend 20% of my time dealing with physical disability, I spend 20% of my time dealing with this or that. It will be looking at the issues that actually will affect most disabled people in Scotland. And as you're right, you know, we have, you know, one in five people have a disability. But if you go beyond that and look at what effect it then has on their friends and their families, we are looking at a very high proportion of people.
Okay, thanks for that. I mean, one of the issues that's come up in our evidence sessions is human rights, and saying that perhaps rather than commissioners for a number of different areas, having beefing up the Scottish Human Rights Commission so that they could actually look at some of these rights-based issues might be a more effective way forward, with perhaps a rapporteur looking at specific issues, for example, such as disability. What's your view on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think I've heard that and I've read the submission about that. I mean, I think my concern would still be that disability would be left behind compared to a lot of the other protected characteristics, because of the reasons I've given, that actually for many disabled people, they find it very difficult to engage, have the energy, have the ability to do that. Now, there's lots of good third sector charities doing work in this already, but it's not often holistic, and there can be sometimes, you know, rightly so, conflicting views around that. So I would be still deeply concerned that if we simply gave more powers to a commission who have had a lot of power already and haven't really focused in on disability, would they again be left behind? Maybe not next year, but, you know, we've got to future-proof this for hopefully 5, 10, 15 years, 20 years down the road.
Thanks for that. Now, I'm intrigued as to why I think a commissioner should be established for a period of up to 8 years. Why was that time period kind of selected?
That seems to be, I think I will turn to my first, but my understanding is that is the kind of normal period, but I don't know if Nick wants to come in on that one.
Thanks, Jeremy. Yes, that was we took that from the standard process for other appointed commissioners supported by the SPCB.
But it wasn't looking at this specific.
Wasn't specific to this bill. No.
Right. Okay, fair enough. Now, in terms of the financial memorandum itself, there's obviously quite a big variance, and some of the evidence that we've received is that they feel that that's a kind of very small C conservative estimate of the costs. You vary from 574,000 up to 878,000 ongoing once it's established. So, how robust are these figures? And also, we have an organisation's Disability Equality Scotland has concerned that the bill, I quote, could have an indirect implication of reduced funding for their organisation as funds may be diverted to the Commissioner.
Can I take that second question first, if that's okay, and then maybe leave the detail to Nick and Liz? I mean, I've heard this argument used by a number of third sector charities. We're worried that we're going to lose, if the money will be diverted from what we get to this commissioner. Well, that is a political choice. And I would be deeply concerned whether any government coming forward would then say that. Now, that's not happened with the Children's Commissioner. You know, we haven't seen children's and young people's charities in any way seen their funding change because of that. And that, you know, I think is rightly so. So that would be a political choice by a government. I would be deeply disappointed, and I would hope other MSPs would be challenging that, but if they took money away from them simply because of Commissioner. This is a very different role, and we still need to fund the third sector. I'll maybe bring in Nick in regard to the kind of robustness of the figures.
Come in a minute. Yeah, as Jeremy said in his opening statement, the costings were found, estimates were found through consultation with SPCB officials, so we had conversations with them on the figures. We also looked at recent financial memorandums for office holders that have been set up or are in the process of being set up, and the annual accounts of already established office holders. So that was the kind of basis of evidence that the FM was what we use for the FM. So.
But the FM doesn't include provision for participation, legal or investigation staff, and the costs associated with that engagement and participation are considered to be conservative. So,
it was in consultation with the member that we kind of decided how many members of staff were going to be provided for in the FM. I think it was really based on what more recent commissioners, that's been the kind of standard for staff members. There could be more staff members, it would always be for the commissioner to kind of consult with SPCB if they wanted more staff members.
Sorry, and the cost of those four staff members would be just short of £250,000 a year, and £130,000 would be the cost just over for the commissioner, would that be right?
I think that sounds right, if that's what we have in the FM there.
That's cost including salary, including not just salary, but other costs. Thank you. Okay. I'm just wondering, in terms of this overall kind of picture, the SPCB has raised concerns with us about the proportion of their budget that's being used for paying commissioners and for funding commissioners, which, as you know, has increased from about 16.2 to about £80.2 million in the current financial year. This would add to that, even at the fairly modest figures here, if they are indeed accurate. So you said earlier that it's a political choice, but does that mean the Scottish Parliament budget should be increased, or do you think that other areas of the Scottish Parliament should have to cut their cloth in order to fit in this commissioner and indeed others, Jeremy?
I think that is a good question for the Finance Committee maybe to address themselves. My own view would be that if as a Parliament we believe that this is the right way forward, it has to be appropriately funded. Now, I probably think that should probably come from an increase within the budget for the Parliament, but I think that's a debate that can take place, you know, in other places. But I think it was very interesting in one of the evidence sessions last week, one of the speakers very powerfully said, this is an investment in our society. And if an investment is worth making, it is worth making. And I think this is a really important investment we would be making in a group of individuals. And it is ultimately individuals we're looking at. It's a group of individuals who are pretty well marginalised and left behind in society in many, many cases.
Okay, and you don't think the funding would be removed in any way, shape or form from frontline services? You said earlier on that money hadn't been reduced from, for example, other charities and other organisations that had commissioners, such as Children's Commissioner.
Yeah, I mean, I would hope it wouldn't be. That would be a choice for ultimately the government and this Parliament to make in regard to when it sets its annual budget. But I would be disappointed very disappointed if that happened.
OK, I'm going to open up the session now to colleagues around the table. First will be John, to be followed by Liz.
Hey, thanks, Convener. To follow on that point, you're saying that the money for the Children's Commissioner, you know, hasn't been diverted from elsewhere, but it does mean that Scotland's budget is reduced by that million or 2 million. So, inevitably, there is less money for other things. Now, you might argue that that is better used for Commissioner, but would you at least accept that it is not available for other things?
Yeah, I mean, you are right, Mr. Beeson, in regard to that. And I suppose what are our priorities as a parliament and what is our priorities as a society? Now, I am sure I could go through and easily find, or reasonably easily find, the amount of money that I think is better prioritised. Now, that is a debate that, you know, is a decision we have to make. But I think if we see this as an investment into those in society, then I think it's a justifiable amount. And as you know, I think the figures are robust. I think because we've got already have a lot, we have commissioners there, that these aren't figures that we simply plucked out of the sky. I think this is one of the most robust financial memorandums that have probably been produced in regard to a non-government bill.
Finance Committee all have a view on that, but anyway. There are some strong, as we mentioned already, there are some strong advocacy groups out there, RNIB, lots of groups, doing really good work. I get your point that that could be more joined up, so that would be one of the reasons for having a commissioner. The other thing you mentioned is investigations. I just wonder if you could explain a bit more. There's not a huge budget, I don't think, for investigations. So can you explain what would be involved in that, and would it be quite limited or would it be quite extensive?
Yeah, I mean, I just say the budget within the financial memorandum, I think, is a fair amount of money, which would allow them to do some form of investigation work. But it would not, hopefully, be financially exceeding that budget. So I think there will be things. So, for example, an issue at the moment that is very clear for many disabled people, of whatever your disability is in regard to day services. And we have seen, in regard to post-COVID, a lot of local authorities not reopening the day services that were there before COVID. Now, no committee in this Parliament has looked at that. There's been no real debate within Parliament around that. Now, that's perhaps my fault and others' fault, but that is the reality. But yet, for many disabled people, and particularly parents, they are really struggling, because they are having to have much more hands-on care throughout the day. Now, that is a type of investigation that would not take a lot of money, but I think would be more likely to be picked up on by us as politicians and by the media if it was done by a disability commissioner than if it was done simply by one charity.
If we take that forward, so the commissioner produces a report that says day services have been cut and that's a bad thing, now, in the actual investigation, presumably councils and others would comment, so there would be a bit of a cost there. But where would we go then? Because it makes the point, I think, that there would be no powers to enforce on the part of the commissioner. Would the idea be to embarrass the local authorities so that they had to spend money on day services?
I think it would be to highlight to us as politicians and to the Parliament in regard to this is an issue, what are you going to do with it? And I think partly it would also be given opportunity for people to have a voice, and that voice is not being heard at the moment within this Parliament or within government as effectively as it could be if it was targeted, in my opinion. And so ultimately the choices that we make come down to government and Parliament, local authorities. But I think we have seen with the Children's Commissioner issues that weren't on the agenda a number of years ago, now on the agenda, because they have highlighted it and because they have kept going on and highlighting it over and over again. So I think there is a role for simply bringing these issues to the attention and saying, this is an issue, ultimately it's up to the Parliament to decide what we do with it, but at least it's now within the public domain.
But I mean, it just seemed to me that if we've got a reasonably fixed pot of money, and I know we can change the budget a little bit, but that just means either the Parliament or the local council is going to shift resources to wherever the louder voice is. And if disabled people have not had a voice, now they're going to have a voice. So they take money maybe out of schools and put it into more services for disabled people or out of colleges or out of somewhere. But I mean, that is where we're going. And then presumably we need a commissioner for schools, or we need a commissioner for colleges, or, you know, for anything, because everybody feels their voice isn't loud enough. I mean, I just wonder where you think we're going with all this.
Well, I'm here to debate a disability commission. I'm not here to look into a silver ball. But, you know, take your rationale. Why have we appointed... Why did you vote for a patient commissioner? Why have you... We have, stage one, as a parliament, voted for a commissioner for people who are victims of crime? You know, so we have taken a view as a parliament, at least one with a stage one, one with an act, that we think that voice needs to be heard. I suppose if you were taking you to your logical argument, you would get rid of all voices and have no voices. And
one argument, yes.
But I would argue that 20% of the population is simply not being heard. And we need that voice to be heard. Now, either we say, let's get rid of all commissioners and let's have no voice, but let's not pick on one of the most vulnerable parts of society to pull up the drawbridge on.
I mean, I do understand your argument, and the committee will be looking at its wider report in due course, but, you know, unfortunately, there are other groups. I mean, you know, women are 50% or 51% of the population. I don't think they've got a commissioner as yet.
They have a really strong voice, and they've got people, you know, you've got people out there advocating on their behalf. Mm-hmm. On social media, you know, and we've got champions in the parliament. You know, people around this table have been champion for women's rights for many years. So I do think you have to look at the individuals that we're talking about here, and we do have to talk about their lived experience, and we do have to look at history, and we have to look at reality, and that voice is not being heard in society compared to many other protected characteristics.
Okay. To move on to another specific area, the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service, I think the prediction, if I'm understanding correctly, is that there will be a low number of prosecutions. And I just wonder, is that a good thing or a bad thing? I mean, do we not want lots of prosecutions?
I don't want to come in on that one, Liz.
So the offences that are in the bill relate to the investigations, and the Commissioner can ask someone to... provide information for that investigation. So it would create offence if they fail to do so without a reasonable reason for doing so. So I guess it's the hope would be that people would be providing that information, I guess, so the offence wouldn't be something that would need to come into force very often, at least. So.
OK. Right, I'll leave it at that. Thanks.
Thank you. Liz, before by Jamie.
Morning. Mr Balfour, obviously when we have been looking at the whole question of commissioners, we have looked at those that have a role that is regulatory. We've had a role for complaints commissioners, we've had a role for those that are investigatory, and obviously the advocacy ones. So there's a broad range of the role that they have. And I think one of the interesting things that's facing the committee just now is that the increasing demand, like your own proposal, relates much more to advocacy. And that has led us, and in some cases witnesses, to question whether the increasing demand for advocacy is because the existing public services and facilities available to support these people are not doing their job adequately. So could I ask you just to reflect on whether you believe that that is the case for a proposed disability commissioner, namely that public services are not looking after them very well? And if the answer to that is they're not looking after them very well, do you think that's related to cost or a lack of understanding, or perhaps both, of the role that they should have?
I think that's an interesting question. I think undoubtedly public services are failing disabled people in regard to you know, many issues that are happening. So it's not just the kind of big headline grabbing issues, but it's often the small issues that I don't think particularly local authorities, but also health boards are picking up on that. So often people, you know, there's a big debate going on, and you know, I don't want to go down that road in regard to what type of transport system we should have in city centres. But very often it's for disabled voices not heard, and they are the ones who are affected by the changes the most. So I think there's a lack of understanding. I think many people will do a tick box exercise, but they won't actually engage with the disabled community. So, let me give you a very basic example. I think it is great that we keep the main roads clear when it snows, and it's really important that the buses run. But I live 200 yards, 300 yards from my nearest bus stop. So if you don't clear the pavement for that 200 or 300 yards, I can't get to the bus stop, which means I then can't get to work, although obviously I can come online, but for many people we can't. If you've got a wheelchair, so the policy that many local authorities have is that we keep the main roads open, but we never clear the side streets until it all melts away. Well, you're then immediately saying to somebody who has a mobility issue, you are then being housebound for that longer period of time.
I mean, I think that's a very valid point that you make. In fact, I have had constituents in some of my areas in Mid Scotland and Fife who've said exactly that point. Do you think, however, that that scenario, which is very difficult, and you're quite right to say in some cases it means that disability groups are housebound for that period, do you think that has come about because of a failure of a local authority to address the problem adequately and because of certain cutbacks? Because you mentioned in your earlier focus about COVID, where, as we all know from COVID, that's been a particularly difficult period for local authorities with their financial arrangements. The point being, can we solve these very genuine issues by looking at the services provided by local authorities and, in some cases, Scottish Government, rather than by a commissioner? That's the key question.
I think it's not either or, but I think the problem is if there's no voice to those local authorities or to Scottish Government, and there isn't a voice at the moment really shouting into that, then these issues won't be raised and they won't be dealt with. And I think that is the frustration of the disability community, is that they, I don't think it's a perception, I think it's a reality, are often just not being heard by these organisations. And nothing will change unless that is being advocated. No, so if you were another protected characteristic with a different issue, you would have that voice heard. You would have much more coverage within media, within social media, within the doors of local authorities and this parliament. And because many disabled people just cannot do that, that voice has not been heard. So yes, we do need to change attitudes within local authorities, but I'm not sure that's going to happen unless we've got a much stronger voice holding those local authorities and government to make those changes.
Can I just offer a view in relation to the Patient Safety Commissioner? Because in my opinion, the reason for the demand for the Patient Safety Commissioner came about because of failings within health boards. I speak with considerable experience in the LGML situation, who are, you know, very clear that they want a Patient Safety Commissioner. That has come about because of failures in a particular health board. And that, to my mind, I don't think a commissioner is necessarily going to solve that problem. You've got to go to the root of the problem, which is about the way that the health board was running. And therefore, to reflect on that from a disability commissioner angle, are there problems that we could solve about the delivery of public services which didn't actually really need to have a commissioner, but could be solved by addressing other aspects of the delivery of public services?
To some degree, yes. I think it could be, but I'm not sure it will ever happen unless you have that disability commissioner. Because once this debate goes away, local authorities will move on and deal with other things. And I think there's also there are issues beyond that. I think there is still a society issue in regard to that. So I think if we look at the issues around employability and employment, again, particularly those with hidden disabilities are getting much less opportunities to be in employment. Same is true with those with certain physical disabilities. So I do think there's not just we need to change things. There's a societal issue as well. There is an issue in regard to somebody being able to advocate in regard to just actually perceptions that people have still of disabled people and what disabled people can do. And I, you know, I'll be absolutely honest. You know, before I came to this place, I suppose I thought my experience, having been born disabled, was what most people's experience was with disability. And it was a very positive, inclusive experience. And my eyes were opened when I came here, and I have the opportunity to speak to far more disabled charities and actually speak to individuals with disability. But actually, their experience, we wouldn't accept it for other, you know, for women, for LGBT, we would not accept it for those characteristics, but yet we do seem to still accept it in regard to disability.
I think that's a very fair point, and I just put on the record that I think you've been a wonderful champion for disability groups in all their differences. Just to finish, can I pick up a point that the convener raised, namely, there is potential for considerable overlap in the commissioners that we currently have. Obviously, there are disabled people who are children, who are older people, who are patients. How would you address some of the potential for these overlaps, which obviously could be administratively difficult, but obviously financially too?
I mean, one of the reasons for trying to get the commissioners all into one office is not just purely financial, but actually it's also an opportunity for them to meet much more regularly. In my thinking, and it's only my thinking, there should be some kind of memorandum of understanding between the different commissioners. So if somebody walks into the office who is a child with a disability, and they walk into the Children's Commissioner, or they walk into the new Commissioner for Disability, they wouldn't both do the work, but there would be some kind of agreement that we're working this at the moment, so we'll deal with that, and then if it's not that person. And I think the honest answer to your question as well is that there's plenty of work to go around. You know, having met with the Children's Commissioner, having met with other commissioners, you know, they're having to lay aside lots of work because they don't have the time to deal with it. So I don't think any disability commissioner is going to struggle to find enough to fill their, you know, Monday to Friday calendar. So I you know, there's enough issues out there that I can list already that are not being picked up on by disability commissioner could do. But there does need to be some kind of understanding that we don't all follow the same issues, and I hope that can be done by sensible people sitting down and discussing it.
Thank you.
Jamie to follow by Ross.
Morning, Jeremy. I just wanted to, really on the points that you just made there, I mean, I was contacted by constituents about roads that were not suitable, local roads in their area that was preventing them from leaving their homes because of their limited mobility. I contacted the council. The council remarkably actually went out and dealt with it and sorted the situation. You know, like you've been in many cases, I was the advocate there and I got that situation sorted out. Are you hoping the commissioner would deal with larger issues, more general issues than that? It's not going to, we're still going to be those advocates on the kind of lower level, as it were, or the small level, so it would be a wider issue. And if that's the case, I mean, you know, large charities already come together on issues such as shared surfaces. Why would this approach be a more effective way of dealing with those larger issues?
I think, to address your first point, absolutely, you know, the Commissioner cannot pick up every local issue across all 32 local authorities. It simply would not work that way. So there's still going to be a very vital role, continuing role for councillors, for MSPs, MPs, to be advocating on local issues. What we need to challenge is not why, you know, you did well to get that local street cleared, but what about the street next door? So we need a policy change within local authorities, that this policy changes. Yeah, I mean, I think the third sector charities do an amazing amount of work. They do, you know, a really positive amount of work. But it's interesting, they themselves are in favour of a disability commissioner. So they don't see this as some kind of threat that's going to be taken away from the role that they play. And I think where the disability commissioner can help is there still is a wee bit of kind of, you know, this is my disability, this is, you know, and I bring people together on that. I would want to see a much more holistic approach around that. So you're bringing together everybody on a certain issue. So there will still be a role for all the third sector, but this will be, I think, an amplified voice, will be somebody who can hopefully also have better access to those who are making decisions in different areas.
When we were just talking, or you were talking earlier about the staff salaries, and I think, Liz Anderson, you suggested that I don't know, if perhaps I don't want to put words into your mouth, but almost this is the kind of standard, this is how many staff we think we'll need. What roles would those staff be?
We haven't deliberately broken it down because I think we're not here to write the job description for the individual. So that, I think once the Disability Commissioner, if they are appointed, would be for them to decide what they think, well, one, what are their strengths and weaknesses, and then what other strengths and weaknesses do they need to bring that team together. But that would be the budget that they would have to play with.
Right, so so at the moment...
One of them is going to be a researcher, one's going to do this, one's going to do that. I think that's up to the Commission to decide what they think they need once they are appointed.
Okay, and I mean, I get the point that you made earlier about a more holistic approach and others, but I mean, the third sector, there are a lot of very good third sector organisations, obviously specialists in their areas, but working together, as we've said. They are far better resourced than this role will be. So are you not concerned that, or I suppose, how will a disability commissioner with full staff still to be determined exactly what the roles, but I imagine there'll be a communications person in there somehow to get messages out and an office administrator. So that's starting to reduce the number of people that are doing direct advocacy and direct investigation. How will they be able to deliver more than, you know, far better resourced third sector organisations?
I think firstly, any commissioner worth their, doing the job properly will want to engage with the third sector charities. So, you know, I've made it, you know, when I've been going around talking to people, the first thing that we need to do is get out there and hear what are the issues, what are people saying, who's doing what already within, you know, the third sector. And, you know, I think the Commission can also bring together groups and get them to work together. And so he can be or she can be the individual that brings those groups together and help run the campaigns, help focus on the campaigns. So they don't necessarily have to do all the work themselves. They can also be a facilitator as well. And we've seen that with the Children's Commissioner. The Children's Commissioner has been very good at bringing together children's charities and binding them all together. And so I hope it's a very close working relationship that the Disability Commissioner would have with the third sector. And any campaigns, they may be running it, or they may be facilitating it, or they may be simply bringing people together to run that.
And I know you wouldn't want to write the role or the responsibilities or certainly do the recruitment, but what background would you expect the Commissioner to have?
Yeah, I thought fairly long about that question, because I think it's a genuine question. We haven't said within the bill that they have to have a disability themselves, because there are actually people, many good people out there who either had experience of disability through family or through work and through other areas. So clearly they have to understand disability. They have to understand the issues that those within the disability context are facing. If I could write the ideal person, they would have some lived experience of disability themselves. But I don't think that has to be in the bill.
To come from the charity sector?
No, I think they could come from a number of different sectors. I think they could, they may come from many different backgrounds, but see this as a role that they can play. So they may come from the third sector, they may come from other professional backgrounds, they may come from somebody who doesn't have a professional background but has the skills set out for that. So I think we want to, if it happens, we want to throw the net as wide as possible and not limit ourselves in regard to who would be able to apply for a job.
Mm-hmm. And in the discussions or exchanges earlier, you talked about the number of new commissioners which have obviously been suggested or are in the process of kind of going forward potentially. But obviously there are concerns about how they deliver. So I suppose I'd ask you, how would you measure outcomes? I mean, would you have a process so that a disability commissioner can say at the end of every year in their report, this is what we've achieved, this is how we've made things better, and how would you see things of having changed perhaps by the end of that 8-year term as well?
Yeah, I mean, clearly the commissioner has to be independent, so we can't be telling them what to do, but we do an annual report which comes to Parliament, and I think that would be an opportunity for maybe a number of committees to scrutinise what the work that we've done over the last annual year. But I mean, I think for me, and I suppose we all say this, but you know, in 10, 15 years' time, it would be great if there was no disability commissioner, because actually disability wasn't seen as an issue, and actually disabled people were getting the services, the employment opportunities, everything that the rest of society gets. So, you know, in an ideal world, you would work yourself out of a job. I think we can measure that in regard to what progress has been made. And I think there are things around transport, social health care, employability, that, you know, if that commissioner is not moving it, it's an 8-year appointment, but there's a 4-year gap. So, you know, I think there would be questions, if nothing's changed in that 4-year period, they may not be the individual you're looking to reappoint again for a second term.
I think we've heard that from a number of people that have given evidence in previous sessions on the commissioner landscape, that actually, you know, one of the kind of plus points would be if commissioners did their job, made things better and living. But we don't seem to have any commissioner that's anywhere close to saying, on the advocacy side, well, that's me done, I've achieved everything, you know, we can move on. So I think those outcomes are really key. And as I say, I think a concern we have is actually these proposals come through and some commissioners obviously are in place, and we're not actually seeing, they're not able to measure the outcomes of what they've achieved. I think that's a real concern.
I mean, I would be deeply worried that if I think we do need to set absolutely some kind of goals, some kind of criteria that we can measure that by. I think that's one of the problems we have from the public sector generally, is that it's very difficult to measure these things. So,
should those measurable outcomes be part of the bill, though? Should they be very clear before this goes through? Because, as I say, it's a concern with other pieces.
I think you raise a really important issue, which I'd quite like to reflect on. And if we ever got to a stage, if we get to a stage two, or when we get to stage two, yeah. I think I would be open to that type of discussion and amendments.
Thanks. Just last quick point, if that's all right. There wasn't really any order this as I scribbled things down, but one of the kind of areas, I think, you know, you talked about the kind of relationship between charities and others. Do you have a kind of concern, or could you consider it an issue that, unless an issue is an issue that the Disability Commissioner takes forward, it might be ignored by government?
No, I hope not. I mean, I think, as you've said, many of the third sector charities are quite well resourced, and I think they will still be seeing it as an issue for them. I mean, some of the issues are actually quite complex, and you know, it's probably not like some of the other protected characters. There's not one answer. So the one I always give is in regard to drop curbs. If you are an individual who has certain disability, a drop curb is really helpful. So if I've got a wheelchair, it means you can get across the road. If you're a person who has a guide dog, it's actually a nightmare because the dog doesn't know that you're coming to the end of a pavement. So you've got two slightly conflicting issues there, and that will be an issue for a disability commissioner to work through. You know, how not all the issues will be the same for every disabled individual. So you may want that disability commissioner to be able to almost advocate on two areas where what a charity who's got a particular interest will only advocate on that issue.
Okay, thank you.
Ross. Thank you, Convener. Morning, Jeremy. I'd like to just follow up on Jamie's initial question with the example of an individual MSP advocating for a disabled constituent and move that to a kind of whole Parliament level, which touches on some of the points you're making before. Because I understand entirely what you're saying around the difficulties that disabled people have advocating for themselves using their own voice in settings like Parliament. But there's a question for us as an institution, because it's something that our inquiry into the wider commissioner landscape has touched on a few times. These wider issues of effective parliamentary scrutiny, questions of reform 25 years into devolution. I presume part of the motivation, my understanding, that you've got for bringing this bill forward is that sense that Parliament as a whole has not been effective enough in advocating for, legislating for, etc., disabled people. Why do you think that is? If we can move from Jamie's example of the individual MSP level to the institution as a whole, what is holding the institution back from effectively fulfilling that job, that and from holding it back so far that there is a need for an independent commissioner in that space?
I think it probably goes back to one of the points I made earlier. Getting out of bed takes 90% of my energy. So actually, I'm not sure the thought is totally at the Parliament's issue, because there's so many voices that we hear day in, day out. But I think for many disabled people, actually, to get to the Parliament, to get onto the email, to phone you up, to advocate, is actually very difficult because of the time and energy that that takes. And that's particularly true, I think, for parents. If you're trying to literally, you know, get your child out of bed, dress them, feed them, care for them, before having to write an email to an MSP or to come to a protest outside the Parliament, is actually just beyond most individuals' ability. So I think there is that. I think clearly as a Parliament, we do have to keep reflecting on, are we engaging with the community? But the community also have to have that energy and that ability to be able to do that. And I think just for many people with disability, they find that very difficult to do. And your disability comes with then other issues and other things that you're trying to deal with.
I appreciate that. And I realise this is somewhat going back onto ground that's already been covered. But given that, I mean, there are already, as has been mentioned, there's a range of third sector organisations, charities, etc., who do advocate on behalf of disabled people and can do so effectively on behalf of the people who find it most difficult to do it for themselves. They lobby us, give evidence, etc., on a very regular basis, some very effective organisations. What you're proposing is adding something new to the landscape. And I get the logic of if there wasn't that landscape of organisations already advocating for disabled people, having somebody to do that and to gather those voices, gather those experiences, and then bring it to Parliament, there would be a very clear case for that. What I'm not sure of, though, is why there is a case for it when we already have that wider landscape of people who do that. So that's where my question is Parliament not responding to them effectively?
No, I get that. I mean, I think it's very interesting. If you go back and read the stage one evidence taken for the Children's Commissioner, those were exactly the same questions that were being asked then. You know, there's lots of children's charities out there who are advocating to the Parliament. Why do you need the same thing? And I think there is something about bringing it together. I think you can see the effectiveness of a Children's Commissioner compared to other children's charities had over the last number of years. So I think the questions you are asking are absolutely legitimate. I think they were asked and answered with the Children's Commissioner. I think that's where I would want to draw a very similar line on, in that in no way are we trying to push out or minimise what the third sector do, but I think there is a place for an individual, for a commission to have that collective voice, which is really important. And also they can look forward, they can look at legislation, they can see what are the issues that are facing people going forward in regard to that, which often charities don't have the time to do. So I think I would answer by, you know, almost saying, let's go back and look what's the same arguments happened with Children's Commissioner. I think we can answer them the same way with a Disability Commissioner.
That's a good point, thanks. And just finally, on a point of process, you're obviously aware of our inquiry into the wider commissioner landscape. Do you think it would make sense for Parliament to consider the report and the recommendations that this committee produces before moving ahead with not just your own bill, but we've got a range of bill proposals at the moment for the creation of new commissioners? Would it make sense for Parliament to consider what we end up recommending before proceeding further with any of the range of individual commissioner proposals to avoid a potential mismatch between what we all end up agreeing for the landscape overall and what we are doing on a case-by-case basis over the rest of this term?
I mean, I think, you know, what we are 50 months away from Scottish Parliament elections, whatever, is not that far down the road. I do wonder whether we'll get that consensus within that period of time. I do wonder whether we'll have time to, you know, I don't think the government, whoever's in government, in 15 months' time will have the time to take your recommendations and turn them into legislation. So I don't think that will happen in this term. So I do think we should proceed with the Disability Commissioner at this point, because I think the issues that we are facing aren't going to go away. And I think it will be for the next Parliament, with due respect to this committee, that will look at your report and then decide what we want to do with it. I just can't see the timescales fitting for you to produce your report, for government to reflect on it. There'll be then consultation with lots of groups and individuals, and that all happening before we face the electorate in whatever is 15 months' time. So I think I'd be very worried that if this was put on hold and then let's come back and look at it in the next Parliament, well, who knows who will be here? Who knows whether that will be something somebody wants to take forward? I think we should push ahead. I welcome your 360 review. Let's see what you as a committee come up with, and then let's see how government and civic society respond to what you've said. But that's not going to happen in 15 months unless unless a miracle happens.
Thanks, and thank you for that distressing reminder of how close our next election is.
Actually, it's 23 months, not 15.
Oh, sorry, my apologies.
So there's still a wee bit of time left. Just a couple of points that have come up from colleagues' questions. I mean, you yourself raised a couple of issues. One, you talked about daycare centres not reopening after COVID, and I know that is a concern. But in my area and others, people say, well, it's a shortage of staff and cash resources. And in the issue you raised about, for example, very practical issue of, people have been unable to leave their homes because the council focuses on arterial routes, which they obviously have to do for emergency services, public transport, enable people to get to their work. You know, in our area, I'm sure many others have put grindbins in streets so that some people can at least do the areas in front of their homes. How would either of these two issues be improved by a disability commissioner? And even if he or she highlights those, it's not going to make a material difference on the ground. So, for example, with the snow issue, the local authority is not going to necessarily have more depots full of trucks and salt and staff to put the stuff out on the streets. So, I mean, it's one thing highlighting an issue. As Jamie pointed out, how do you change the outcomes?
Because I think you get to that. I think the Disability Commissioner gets in at an earlier stage to raise these issues. So this is policy issues rather than implementation issues. So I think there's a debate going on, certainly within my local authority and I think other local authorities, at a very high level in regard to what type of day centres are appropriate going forward. So, should people be going to one place? Should it be an individual care? So that's a much wider philosophical debate that's happening at the moment. But often I don't think the disabled voice is being heard in regard to that. So I think it's getting in at an early stage of policy and raising some of the issues. So again, if I can take a very local issue, but I think it's an issue that will be happening across other towns and cities within Scotland. And that is in regard to, so in Edinburgh we have George Street, which many of you will know. There's an issue of, do we stop cars driving on George Street? Now that's a really important debate to happen, but I only heard about the consultation very late on. Many disabled groups hadn't heard about it at all, and there was a real danger that we were going to stop people being able to access places of work because of a policy. So before that policy is implemented, the Disability Commission needs to be at that level. So when government are bringing forward ideas, whether that's around transport, education, we need a Disability Commissioner there advocating at a philosophical level of that policy with a disabled voice, which I don't think is happening at the moment.
But given the intricacy of some of the issues you've talked about and how very localised they are, I mean, how could a commissioner with four staff possibly deal with that? I mean, I think you
deal with every issue, but we can also highlight that issue to charities that are working in that local area. So there will be a role for information sharing as well. So there will be a role for to say, if something's happening in Ayrshire, something's happening in Arran, do you know about that and have you responded to it?
Michelle?
Hi. Good morning. Late entry from myself. Just picking up, firstly, on that theme. I mean, councils will do their EQIAs for exactly that sort of thing. So is what you're outlining not simply suggesting that existing functions and processes are not necessarily being followed properly rather than a genuine argument for a commissioner?
I think it's both. I don't think it's been done properly often. I think it's often a tick box exercise. But actually, I think, you know, a lot of what happens in regard to policy is driven by public opinion, and we've seen that. And that public opinion, for many people, doesn't involve a disability voice. And I think what we need to, part of a role for commissioner, will be that voice, not just to civic society, not just to government and civic society, but will also be a societal issue as well. And I think that's some of the things we need to be challenging as well. Again, you know, can this person work? Again, just taking a very personal example, the first job I went for, the only issue they were concerned about was, could I use a photocopy or not with my disability? And that was the deciding issue of whether I got the job or not. So I think, you know, that type of issue needs to be challenged as a societal issue about not what can't you, but what can you do?
I mean, I've listened to the session with great interest, and there is no denying the power of your advocacy for disabled people. But in general terms, what I'm hearing for is a lot of arguments where I would take a slightly counter view, similar to what I just said about an EQIA, where there are issues within all the various forms of government where maybe these processes are not being done because they're time consuming and they're expensive and they're often difficult, particularly where you get rights that come into contract, into competition, and we've seen that before. That's proven quite difficult. So I suppose my question really is, to what extent have you considered that actually you're operating out the best of intent, but in reality you're really desperately seeking to plug a gap that is there, in which case the question is, why can't we, the Parliament, all of us, plug that gap without a commissioner?
Well, we haven't done it for 25 years. So that gap is there. That gap is going to continue because who's going to advocate on behalf of that? You know, we all move on to different issues. We all move on to different things. Something else hits our email. Something else hits the media. I suppose that is the point the disability community is saying, is there have been organisations out there who have been running for many years, many commissions which could have done this, but they haven't. And I think I would come back and say, you know, we have given civic society, we've given other organisations the opportunity to do it. I think the evidence is clearly that they haven't done it. So let's use this commissioner to be someone who's really positive, who can take forward and challenge government, local authorities, health boards, and see that change within society. Because if we don't, the landscape will not change and we will leave people behind further and further. So I think my challenge would be, if we were starting at year one, if we went back to 1999 and said, okay, well, let's give the Parliament, let's give Scottish Government, let's give all these organisations the opportunity to do it. Even let's give the different commissioners we have brought forward in the last number of years. But they haven't done that. And my point, I think, is, you know, you will move on to another inquiry. Other committees will move on to other issues, but that voice will still not be heard.
And again, I hear a very powerful argument and advocacy for that. From my perspective, and I'm just playing devil's advocate, arguably, as a woman, women have been disproportionately discriminated against for thousands of years, and with each gain we make, it feels as though we slip back. If you look at the pay differentials, for example, even the matter of women's rights has been under discussion and dispute in the last few years. Is that not then I should be thundering out and making an argument for a women's commissioner? And there you end up with, because for me saying that about women, there are a multitude of other groups, and suddenly we end up with a parliament run by commissioners rather than by the democratically elected people.
I hear your point, but I think there is a difference here in that I would argue that there's very loud voices advocating on behalf of women. Now, clearly, we don't always, it doesn't always bring the change you want, but I don't think anyone is unaware of the issues that you are addressing in regard to women. I think, and I think in regard to other protected characteristics. I think my point is that disabled people don't have those voices, and they are, because of the disability and because of that effect that has on day-to-day life of many people, they will never have that strong advocacy voice that other people within society do have. And so, I think to take your argument logically, you, a bit like what Mr. Maitland said, you would want to get rid of all commissioners. And that may well be where you want to go. My issue would be, until we get to that point, let's not discriminate against some of the most vulnerable people in society whose voice is not being heard and who do not have the champions that other groups have within society.
Okay, thank you. Any final points you want to make, Jeremy?
I'm content.
Okay, well, thank you very much. I want to thank you and officials for the evidence that you have given this morning. The next item on our agenda will be discussed in private, and it's a consideration of our work programme, so it's going to call a 2-minute break while we move into private session, allow broadcasting official report to leave. Thanks.